Hi, I'm Jenni Smillie and I'm a research fellow here in the Particle Physics Theory Group in Edinburgh. We're now going to talk about the weak force. Like the strong force, this is one which is only really active over tiny length scales, well within the size of an atom, for example. So in everyday life, we're really not aware of feeling the weak force, and this gave it its name, weak. But in many ways, it's quite misleading because it's responsible for some very important effects that we do see around us all the time. For example, it's responsible for one of the key steps in the chemical reactions within the sun that give us heat and light all around us. And it's also responsible for radioactive beta decay. So today we're going to start by looking at radioactive beta decay and the series of experiments which taught us about the weak force. And then we'll go on to study the force carriers of the weak force in detail, like the photons and the gluons that we've met before. But the big difference is that these have a non-zero mass, and we'll see what impact that has. So beta decay is where a neutron within an atomic nucleus changes into a proton, releasing energy. So we met the last time the neutron and the proton. We know that the neutron, for example, consists of an up quark and two down quarks. And the proton is two up quarks and one down quark. So to change from one to the other, then one up quark and one down quark don't need to change at all. However, between this down and this up quark, something has to happen, and this is the decay process. And the energy, the radiation that is produced here, is the beta radiation. And already we know something about this radiation, because the electric charge on this side is zero, the electric charge on this side is plus one, and so this has to carry negative electric charge in order for charge to be conserved. As well as charge, we know that energy must be conserved. And so if we know the energy on this side, and we know the energy of the final system with the proton, then we must know the energy of this particle that is produced. In fact, in 1900, Henri Becquerel was able to show that this particle was the same electron that was being studied in other experiments. And therefore, we were already piecing together parts of the weak force. But there was something strange about the energy of these electrons. If you draw a graph of the energy here, and then the number of electrons with that energy, then given you know energy before and after, all of the electrons produced should have the same energy at a particular value, and you should get just one discrete peak, as indeed you see in other decay processes. But instead, what they saw was a continuous spectrum that went like this. And it never exceeded this value that was predicted, but you can see from the shape of this peak here that many, or most of the time, the electrons were produced having lost really a lot of the energy. And it appeared that energy was missing in this process. And this caused a real problem for physicists of the time, and indeed led some of them to question whether energy was really conserved at all. But in 1930, Wolfgang Pauli suggested that maybe there was another solution, that there wasn't energy missing, we just had missed seeing it. So the electron was being produced, but if another particle was produced at the same time, it could carry away the energy and we wouldn't observe it and would see a spectrum like this instead. And he was right. And the extra particle produced is one we now know is part of a family of particles called the neutrinos. And although it was 1956 before those particles were actually officially discovered. So this line here actually is not just one beta radiation. Instead, if you have your down and your up quark, then what is being produced is your electron, and this particular neutrino is the anti-electron neutrino in this process. Now, when we looked at both electromagnetism and at the strong force, there we saw that these forces were carried by a type of particle called bosons, and it's exactly the same for the weak force. So we can actually do better with this diagram still and zoom in further. And what you actually see is that there's a force carrier here that is then decaying to give you this electron and this antineutrino. And you'll notice here that I deliberately drew this with a W minus. The W just stands for weak. It's the name given to the carrier of the weak force. But the minus is because it does indeed carry electric charge. It must do to conserve charge at each point in this interaction. And this is exactly the charge that is carried by the electron. And so it shows that this W does actually interact with the electromagnetic force. Now, many times we talk about four fundamental forces as if they're independent things, but really they are not. And in fact, the weak interaction is completely coupled with electromagnetic interactions. And in 1956, the Nobel Prize was given to Glashoff, Salam and Weinberg for precisely unifying these different theories. So now we see a process like this. There are, in fact, a number of other processes that are very similar. Firstly, you can do a kind of reverse, where an up quark becomes a down quark, and there, instead, you have a W plus. The charge has now gone from plus to minus, so it has to be the opposite sign. And here, for example, you can have a positron, and this becomes an electron neutrino. There's one last piece in this puzzle, which is that the weak force does also have a boson that is electrically neutral. There is a neutral one, but it is slightly different to the two W ones, entirely because of this interaction with the electromagnetic force. And the fact that they are so combined means you will never observe a W0. So in any physics process, you won't have a W0, and instead what you see is a particle that we call the Z. It's also a heavy boson, and in fact, it's just fractionally heavier than the charged W plus and W minus. So we've seen that for the weak force, the W's and the Z's play the same role as the photons and gluons that we've seen before, but the difference is that now they have non-zero mass. In fact, they really are very heavy. The mass of a W is 80.4 giga electron volts over c squared, where again, we're using these strange particle physics units for masses. But if you compare these to the mass of, say, the proton or the neutron, which are about 0.9 giga electron volts over c squared, then that really is very heavy, 80 times as heavy, in fact. And it's actually quite surprising that in a reaction which just changes one of these particles to the other, you can produce something that is as massive as this. And the only reason that we can do that actually is because of quantum mechanics. It's a quantum effect that allows you to borrow energy, provided you do it only for a very short amount of time. But now, what is the real difference to having a massive force carrier to a massless one? If we return to electromagnetism for a bit, there we saw that you have a Coulomb potential, where if you have two charges with a charge Q1 and Q2 separated by a distance r, then the potential is just the product of these charges, some constants, and then the distance between the two particles. So that was the Coulomb potential. If now you have a massive particle, then this potential changes. It takes the form known as a Yukawa potential, where now the V of R still has some constants that depend on the exact particles involved, but there's extra dependence on the distance, and it has this exponential factor of e to the minus r over r. So the first sanity check is that if we put m equals zero, we do indeed recover something of the form of a Coulomb potential. But the effect of this exponential is actually very strong. If you think of sketching these two potentials, then both become very large when r becomes very small, and both will become very small when r becomes very large. So you get a distribution that's something like that. But the effect of this extra exponential term compared to just straight 1 over r, is to cause this to decay much, much faster. So you'll get curves that go like this, or that actually drop in a way that you simply can't see by eye. And in fact, it's exactly this which makes the weak force such a short-range force. If you put the mass of the W boson into this formula, a typical length scale for the weak force is 10 to the minus 18 metres, which really is a tiny distance. It's about a thousandth of the radius of a proton. And that's why at everyday length scales, you would never actually see this force at all. But this presents us with a bit of a problem, because we want to test the weak force. We want to test that we understand it. And so we need to be able to probe these tiny scales. And we can do this by supplying particles with a large amount of energy. This counteracts the need to borrow energy at all. And as you increase the energy, you probe shorter and shorter length scales. And this image here is actually one of the first collisions that produced a W boson. And this was an experiment which was conducted at CERN many, many years before the LHC, which collided protons and antiprotons and exactly overcame this lack of energy and was able to discover the W plus and the W minus. Later, their heavier cousins, the Z, were also discovered at the same experiment. For now, we'll return to looking at the effect of the mass. So when we first discussed the photon, we discussed that it has these different independent polarizations. And if your photon is traveling in a particular direction, then these polarizations have to be at right angles to that direction. And therefore, there were these two independent polarizations for the photon. But when there's a mass, there's a very big difference to the behavior of a particle. From special relativity, you know that whatever speed you're traveling at, whatever speed a light source is traveling at, then a photon, light, will always travel at the speed of light, at c. Its speed is always fixed and it's always moving. But the same is not true for a massive particle. For a massive particle, you can even stop it. You can have it completely at rest. And that then means that if you impose this condition, that you want the polarizations to be at right angles to the direction, that becomes a meaningless statement, because there is no direction if something isn't moving at all. And so that doesn't give you any constraint. You can have polarizations in any one of the three directions. You call them X, Y, and Z. And indeed, for the massive gauge bosons, they do have these three independent polarization states, which makes them very different then to the massless force carriers. But this is so far working quite well, because we have a force that we understand with massive particles which we predicted and observed, and we have to allow an extra polarization state, but that's okay. However, there is a very, very big problem when we try to develop a theory to describe these massive bosons. We want to write down equations of motion and equations which really describe these bosons in the same way as the Klein-Gordon equation and the Dirac equation that you saw last week. But if you have a massive particle, you need a mass term, but you still have all the same requirements that your theory must have certain symmetries. It must obey certain laws. You can't write down arbitrary terms. And there is simply no way to combine a term for the mass of a boson with these rules, with these requirements of symmetry. And so no theory that anybody could write could describe this theory which had been beautifully experimentally observed. And it is precisely this problem of how you reconcile a mass with the symmetries of the theory that Peter Higgs solved in his groundbreaking work.